It turns out this year, the Grinch is lead times, port congestions, bad forecast, raw materials stuck in Asia, and labor shortages. I heard it's even impacting Santa, and if you didn't get your letter in by August, you might not be getting anything for Christmas. Let's get to it. Welcome, welcome, welcome! Another fabulous, wonderful episode of IBF On Demand. I'm your jolly, passionate, and still not so humble host, Eric Wilson. You can find me at eric@ibf.org. That's eric@ibf.org. We have our returning sponsor, Arkiva, your one-plan S&OP software solution. So please check them out. We talked a little bit a few weeks ago about what's happening in the world, supply chain shortages. The world's on fire right now. And it's an issue that's going to continue through the end of the year and probably, hate to break it to you, into next year as well. It is impacting our holiday season as well. Right now, 40% for a lot of companies, their business is done in these last 3 months of the year. So we're seeing an impact right now with supply shortages and ports being backed up. We're seeing raw materials not coming in and not being able to build things. And these are not things we can correct immediately with expediting labor or anything like that. Because guess what? The labor shortages, there's other countries shut down and having problems. So it's not something we can just flip a switch and fix overnight. These will impact us all the way through the end of the year. They're impacting our holiday. So if it's impacting the shoppers, it's impacting you going to the store or going online and finding out of stock until January, 2022, that's what we're seeing right now. If it's impacting you as the consumer, guess what? It impacts us as the planners then as well. It impacts you as the forecaster, you as the supply chain, you in logistics. It's impacting us as well. So how do we plan? How do we plan our forecast right now and going into next year? How do we plan our supply? What are we doing from a logistics standpoint? What do we do to transition not only to what's going on now, but understanding and interpreting what's going on right now so when we start having to plan for 2022, Q1 2022? Because guess what? We're planning that right now as well. With lead times of excess of 120, 140 days, we're planning March and April as you're watching this podcast. So we need to figure out what's going on. And as of course, I may not have the answers, but I know experts. And I'm bringing an expert today to help answer some of those questions so he can make me smarter and you smarter as well. Pat Bauer. Pat Bauer is a highly experienced supply chain professional and frequent speaker and author. He is a recognized expert and self-proclaimed supply chain nerd. But that's okay because others agree. He's nominated four times by Supply and Demand Chain Executive Magazine as a pro to know and was the very first recipient of IBF's Excellent in Business Forecasting Award. His experience includes roles from Cadbury, Kraft Foods, Snapple, and Comb. He's currently the Senior Director in Supply Chain and Logistics at Aceto, a fine chemical distributor and manufacturer. Help me welcome Pat. So, welcome, Pat.
Hey, Eric. How you doing?
I'm doing great. Happy to have you back on. I guess you're with a new organization right now. I mean, tell me a little bit about what you're doing right now.
Yeah, so I'm now a senior director of supply chain and logistics for Aceto. They're a fine chemical distributor and manufacturer. As a matter of fact, some of our products end up in some of the COVID vaccines. It's a really unique opportunity, neat place after 14 years in consumer goods, working for Comb and the makers of Vagisil and Just for Men. This opportunity came along. It was at the right time. It was company needs a few supply chain building blocks, and they already have a great supply chain team already. So it was a nice transition, nice place to go to after all those years of COM.
I'm excited for you, sir. I'm excited to see you at a conference coming up and still talking about those fundamentals going forward. So I'm excited to be able to share a conference with you as well coming up. Go ahead.
I got to tell you, IBF is such a great forum for learning and for picking up best practices, and for both young and seasoned professionals in the field. I can't wait to get back at it and meet and network with a whole bunch of supply chain folks.
Looking forward to it as well. So we got Christmas coming up, and even though you're currently not building any toys there, you definitely have a lot of experience in supply chain and execution experience. And I've already said, if you know, Santa's got longer lead times this year now as well. If you haven't got your, you know, letters into Santa, you may not get anything for Christmas. We're seeing a lot of problems right now with backups and everything. What exactly is happening? What are we seeing right now? What's causing all these problems?
Well, you know, some of the initial waves of backups at the port were probably just pure bullwhip. And, you know, it's people over ordering on, you know, hedging up on the upside that, or just out of desperation. Certainly when I was in a position where I was ordering up, ordering product, I would just say, get me an extra million of this, or get me an extra 1,000 kilos of this, just to make sure that I had enough. So there was a little bit of bullwhipping that was happening. But right now we have raging consumer demand. We have high consumer confidence. We have a stock market that is at all-time highs, or bouncing around all-time highs. So we have all this tremendous consumer demand happening for hard and durable goods like refrigerators and dishwashers and things like that, coming over. Furniture, you know, people that are looking to get furniture are now looking at 5 or 6 month waits on furniture. So you have all these hard and durable goods taking up an awful lot of container space. I think it comes down to some fundamental conversations around what the supply chain is. And the supply chain is people. So the people that load product onto a ship, people that take it off of a ship, people in customs, drivers, all of these folks have been affected by COVID in some way, shape, or form. Some people have retired early and completely left the supply chain. A lot of drivers, as an example, have retired early, creating this real shortage of drivers. Even though they're adding 500,000 drivers in the last year, there were already 500,000 jobs waiting. So they're not really getting any better, and they've lost a whole bunch of folks to retirement or sickness or death or whatever, all the normal things that happen without necessarily backfilling. And so people, if you take the understanding, the basic understanding that people are the supply chain, that at almost every link in the supply chain, there is some form of constraint that's happening. And most of the time it's people related. It's not necessarily equipment related, although a lot has been made of container and container space and vessel space. That's certainly true. It's really getting the throughput out of pinch points in the supply chain, getting the throughput out of a port, say the Port of LA. Port of LA is sort of the biggest known problem right now in the supply chain. And I'd argue that it's not just the Port of LA, but it's all the people that are transloading and helping with that, and all the drayage drivers. So it's not just getting it into the port, but it's also getting it out of the port. That's problematic. And they're trying to do things to improve it. I read the customs was trying to do a sort of a speed up process on their side to add some sort of more speed into the supply chain. But again, people make it up. People have been affected by COVID. People are staying home and not working because of fear of COVID. Again, people make up the supply chain. So that's why we're facing what we're facing right now.
That is some very insightful, what you said there is impactful. Because, I mean, we always think about the digital supply chain and the analytics and really trying to put together the process. But it really, underlining all those aspects are people. And when you get COVID everyone was been infected worldwide. I know Nike and Crocs, their Vietnam was shut down for a month and it really impacted their supply chain. So really, it's great. I never thought of it, but people really is the biggest constraint and part of the problem we're seeing right now.
If you look at some of the ports, like there's been ports in China and India, which are really significant sources for a lot of the products I just talked about. They've shut down for a week or two on end just because of a COVID outbreak that they're trying to suppress. So that slows up progress along the way.
Okay.
So go on.
I said you mentioned the bullwhip effect in there too. So I want to kind of level set our audience. What do you mean by the bullwhip effect really impacting our shortages now? How does that relate to our shortage today from a bullwhip effect?
Well, it's created this a surge of products, and it may not necessarily be the right product. It's not purely based on a real demand signal, but hedging that happens at every step in the supply chain. So people will add a little bit extra to the forecast to make sure that supply is met. And then the inventory planner will add a little bit more to the inventory plan to make sure that supply is met. And the production planner will do the same. So what started out as a demand for 100 blue widgets has now grown through all the hedging effect to 200 blue widgets. That demand signal goes across to a manufacturer in China, and they in turn start ramping up their operations. Now what's happened is that inventory is moving west. It's moving from east to west. And I think initially there was this massive bullwhip because planning managers and directors like myself would say, order up. We'd tell your master planners, I want as much as I can possibly get as soon as I can possibly get. And it was irrational to a national demand signal. And that big surge, that hedging surge came across and served as a first level of backup. So once the ports got backed up, it's been hard for them to recover. Now what we have is we have people working from home and looking at their environs and saying, I'm not sure I like my house and I'm no different than anyone else. So I'll use myself as an example. I decided to remodel my kitchen, went to buy a refrigerator. My refrigerator has been delayed twice. It's now 2 months from the original expectation date. And I just got a notice yesterday that the dishwasher I bought is now another month out. All because of these delays, because people like me are saying, I want to remodel my house. I think a lot was made over the summer about how much lumber prices went up in the early part of the summer. And it was no different. It was a surge of demand hitting all at once. Some of it was rational, some of it was irrational, but everyone was juicing their forecast. Everyone was juicing their inventory plan, and it created a bullwhip. So plywood isn't just plywood. It's not just wood. It's the adhesives that go between the layer. That those adhesive manufacturers had to surge their demand and their demand profile, add more volume, increase their orders to either a contract manufacturer or their own manufacturing. That in turn created more orders downstream. So bullwhip hit the supply chain, particularly early on, and now it has lingering effects, and that's created this massive backup. The port of LA has been backed up forever. It seems like since the beginning of COVID. I think it started in May or June of last year where it started to surge, but there's always been ships at anchor off the port of LA for the last 18 or 19 months. They've never subsided the number of ships at anchor. They've certainly gone down in number. I think last week they were at 40 or 45 ships at anchor in the port of LA, which is an all-time high. And it's not just an all-time high, it's unusual because they normally carry two or three ships at anchor. And those are just at anchor for a day or two, not for weeks at a time. So it's a real material problem that we have. We've now doubled the amount of transit time for anything coming out of the east going west. It used to be 45 to 50 days, and now it's easily 90 days, probably approaching 100 days. So if you haven't ordered product for Christmas, you're not going to get it. I mean, You know, Christmas is probably 100 days out at this point in time.
Yeah. See, exactly. Right. Your average right now is 95 to 100 days. What you look at. And you mentioned the material. It's really the second and third tier type suppliers that you're starting to see shortages on right now. So yep. You mentioned the bullwhip, Lori, and then that pent-up demand, all those causing capacity, other constraints, people. So we've seen this, I hate to say perfect storm that's really started last May, really coming to fruition right now. What does this mean impact for how you plan? Because you mentioned Christmas, we might as well forget about that. If we haven't planned for it, it's too late.
Right.
But what does this impact planning then going forward through the holidays? How do they look at what's happening from the holidays? How do they look at 2022? How does this impact demand planning, S&OP, supply planning?
You know, it's a really good question. I mean, it has a whole bunch of different potential answers. Certainly, one of the impacts is that mix has been shifted. So say you were a company that had open stock that you sold to retail, and then you also had SIOC packaging or three packs that you also sold into like a Walmart.com. Your mix has been altered pretty radically. Obviously, there's been this decided move towards e-commerce. I'm using Instacart and Grubhub, and I've never used them prior. I mean, I had to learn how to use them. It sounds kind of silly, but I ordered from Amazon, and I order from Amazon pretty heavily, but now I order everything from Amazon. Amazon is essentially my product search bar or anything that I want to buy. So mix has shifted. It's shifted to e-commerce products. More so than anything else. So how do you handle it? I think you really dig down deeper. So, you know, S&OP has typically been product family, and I think you have to dig lower than that, and you have to look at those mixed differences that are happening based on the dynamics of the marketplace. If you've seen a shift inside your business that's moved towards e-commerce, you have to start looking at your e-commerce SKUs with more diligence and vigilance. You have to really get much more in close with what's happening on the consumer side and the pull numbers. So everyone talks about consumption data and using point to sale data. I think that becomes much more important, but not in ways that people typically describe it. I think it's much more important to have conversations around trade inventory and trade or inventory movement and growth. So what is trade inventory? It's kind of the net between growth. Trade inventory growth or movement is what happens when you ship more than they sell through, or they sell more than you ship to an individual retailer. And in the early stages of COVID, trade inventory just went through the roof, especially with e-commerce retailers. E-commerce retailers came in and said, I want to buy 5 or 6 times my normal volume. Again, created all sorts of mixed problems inside of it. I think what you have to do is now come back and look for trade inventory and where the levels are relative to demand and relative to history. So that will give you some insight as to what's happening and whether you're at some sort of balance. I think you also have to look at your own internal balance. How many mismatches do you have? So what's a mismatch? I have 100 bottles, 90 caps, and 50 labels. I'm only able to make 50 bottles fully labeled and capped of whatever the product may be. So you have to start looking at those mismatches. Otherwise, you're going to end up with obsolete inventory or certainly inventory that will be slow moving. Those are opportunities for you to, that's where you should probably spend your time and emphasis in getting some sort of stability. I think you have to look for demand signals that elicit stability, that there's now a level inside the numbers that hasn't been there in the past. And from a long-term perspective, I think you have to record everything that happened. We just now had the biggest black swan event that I've ever seen in the supply chain world. And I think there's learnings from it. And I think you have to record everything that you saw from a consumer consumption perspective, from a shipment perspective, from a trade inventory perspective. I think you have to record that. To be honest with you, it might be a really good time to go and seek like predictive analytics engines that leverage big data and pull them into the mix to try and see if there's any cohort level learnings that you can get out of them. I think there's so much in this that will be case studied out over the next 10 years. But I think there's actions you should take today. And probably the best action you can take is start recording, because that will be available for posterity. So focusing on mix, look at mix heavily, look for stability in any trend line, whether it's shipment, trade, inventory, start looking for stability in the numbers. And you also have to start looking at key indicators of the business and know how your business is driven and know how your consumers inside of your business behave. And that's a whole other set of questions.
Okay. Well, we only got time for probably one more question. I wish I could keep going on for another 30 minutes. Got about 3 minutes, 3 or 4 minutes left. End with an easy question for you. How do we know when we're going to break out of this, or what's that new normal post-COVID look like for demand planning, supply chain, everything? So how do we exactly know when we're going to break out, and what's it going to look like we're seeing?
I think we have to look at COVID incidents, not just in the United States, but around the world. I think you look at number of ships at anchor. I think that's a good measure. There's lots of places where you can see ships at anchor in the port of LA. That will be some indication that the supply chain is freeing up. I think you look at retail inventory to sales. The Fed publishes this number, and right now it's at like 1.0 sales to inventory. It's typically 1.4. That will show that retailers are at least getting back into inventory in the short term. I think you have to pay real attention to what's happening with GDP. GDP for the last two quarters has raged at 6%. The second that number starts coming down, I think you'll start seeing a calming down of some of the bullwhip that we're seeing and some of the surging that we're seeing inside of demand. There's a handful of numbers. Some of them are econometric, some of them are your own. You certainly should understand your own trade inventory position. I think that's going to be tremendously helpful to see whether your company is actually coming back into normalcy.
Okay, so then when is it going to happen? Do you have a date specific when you think this is going to happen?
So we're coming through the holiday season, and then you have Chinese New Year, which is going to cause more surging.
I forgot about that's coming after. That's true.
And then there's a bunch of pent-up demand. We know that inventory isn't at level at retail. The combination of it all, we're not going to see some relenting until the third quarter, and then of 2022. And I can argue that it's going to take us to get through the holiday season of 22 to see some sort of easing of all of this. I believe we're going to see tremendous backups until sometime in 23.
Okay, not great news, but 2023, here we come. Yeah. So, well, thank you very much, Pat. As always, very enlightening. It's very informative having you on. I always appreciate your insights into supply chain and all things S&OP as well. So thank you very much for coming on and letting the audience some insights as well.
Thanks for having me, Eric.
Thank you. This is going to be a totally different type of holidays, totally different type of Christmas. It's not going to be the Christmas of the – it's even not going to resemble last year's, as bad as 2020 was. We're going to see big changes. And some of the big changes we're going to see is more people will be staying home. Okay, I'm not saying we're going to shop less. There's going to be less to buy, yes, but they're not shopping less. They're still going to spend their money, but they may not go out to the stores like you did see, like you saw in 2019, 2018. We've seen this shift begin years ago, and we can continue to see this migration towards online. After what happened last year, and with the continuing, threats that we may see, people are going to be going more and more online. We'll probably see over a 15% increase in online shopping. Some estimated as high as a 20-25% increase this year in online shopping. Our estimates look at about 90% of the people will take advantage of something online this year. They'll either dip their toes or they'll go all in on shopping online. So the majority of people are going to be looking at online shipping. So it's going to be a bigger portion of what you sell is going to be online. That impacts how consumers come to your product. It impacts where your product needs to be. It impacts how the product needs to ship out. And it impacts how you need to forecast it then as well. How you're collecting that data. It's going to impact our seasonal models if you're doing time series type forecasting. It's going to impact your season because you no longer are shipping to a distributor who sends to a store who then eventually gets it out to a consumer. You're cut out a lot of this lead time to the end user, which means the model you're using for seasonality is going to change. Your seasonal indexes will change. Keep that in mind when you're going into 2022 and keep those things in mind when you're looking at forecasting going forward, because there's going to be a bigger percentage in the new norm that goes to online shopping. The holiday season is going to be longer as well. So people are already aware of these longer lead times, and they started shopping before this podcast has even occurred, before Christmas music started on the radio. They've already started shopping, and that's pretty early. But it not only is a elongated season because people are shopping early, but this will extend into 2022 as well. Because I said, you're going online right now, you're seeing out of stock until January 2022. And they're coming back because they still want these items. And they understand that there is some issues with supply chain, and there's some people that are willing to wait. So this is going to elongate into January. I said sometimes February of next year, you're going to see the shopping season for the holiday. And this is going to impact the way the consumers are looking at when you're looking at rolling over demand and pent up demand for certain items that are necessities. You're looking at the it will impact seasonal models once again. It's going to impact your seasonality and your models going forward. It's going to impact those things as well. And we're also seeing a big push to be able to manage cash. The economy, we're seeing inflation issues, but we're seeing these things trickle down to higher prices inside stores, inside of businesses, manufacturers. We're seeing these issues now as well. These higher costs make margins even thinner. So with that, there's going to be a focus on inventories. They focus on inventories right now of what they don't have, but then a focus on inventories and what they want to bring. So this could cause shortages in far into 2022 before we finally recover, because people aren't willing just to dump a bunch of inventory in to try to solve a short-term problem, because that's going to cause mix issues. It's going to cause secondary market flooded with discounts. You're already going to see a lot of this. You're going to, in your own inventory, you will see mix issues probably because of what's going on. People shifting demand, people pulling back from items they did want that you already have on the water. Things of that sort are going to occur. You're going to see mix issues. You're going to see the secondary market flooded because of some of these mix issues, because of inventory coming in late. It's going to flood the secondary markets. You're going to see discounts and pricing being pushed lower. At the same time, pricing is caused higher. We got the perfect storm coming for the beginning of 2022. Be ready for that, because cash will become king. You will need to start managing inventory. When you always start need to focus on that inventory at that point and managing what you have, managing what the consumers want, guess who plays that critical role at that point? You. Forecasting is going to be impacted not only by what you have to plan, by figuring out what's going on right now, but then giving those insights going forward so you can help them manage that inventory. You're going to play a critical role in having those insights. You need to start looking critically right now at what's going on. Look at external variables to try to explain what's happening right now. Bring those into your forecasting process. Don't overreact. make more adjustments more frequently. All the things we talked about past episode about how to deal with the data at COVID, go back, check out that episode. Those are relevant today and relevant now, especially what we're going in through. Well, I'm going to go put up my Christmas tree a little bit early, so I'm going to go decorate it this afternoon. My name is Eric. You can find me at eric@ibf.org, eric@ibf.org. This is IBF On Demand. So check us out. Check out the past podcast. Continue to support us through season four now. Like, share. If you already haven't subscribed, subscribe. Give this podcast a share to other people. We want to grow, continue. We're almost at the 4,000 follower marks. Please help us get it over that hump to the 4,000 mark. So share it with your colleagues and friends. Have them subscribe and follow us as well. We do have a sponsor, Arkiva, your one plan S&OP software solution. So I'm going to end with the talked about the Grinch in the beginning. Here's one of the famous lines from the Grinch.
Maybe Christmas, he thought, doesn't come from a store. Maybe Christmas, perhaps, means a little bit more.
Yeah, it does mean a lot more. It means, you know, logistics and forecasting and supply chain. That is what it means. And guess what? If we don't get that right, we're going to have a pretty sad Christmas this year. So remember, and don't forget, wash your hands.